And we are live.
Your microphone seems a little bit off to me,
Is
just that you know, it sort of echoes a bit in the background
it?
there.
I'll lower the volume on mine a little bit. Is that better?
Yeah, that we'll see anyway. Yeah.
All right. So welcome to Everything is Attitude, not from an ice rink this week. So I know that's going to disappoint a lot of people. Welcome, Rosemary. How are you?
I'm good. Hi, everybody, and hi, Al. Everybody knows you are my lovely co-host on this journey of ours, and so welcome everyone to Everything Is Attitude. Today, this evening, or whatever time it is, wherever in the world you are watching this, we're going to talk a little bit about the energy of the earth and how it affects us, and how, because this is an Everything Is Attitude show, right? And how that knowledge, the knowledge of energy, can affect our attitude, the kinds of attitudes that we might think about having once we have this knowledge of these energy fields. And this subject was inspired actually by someone on the YouTube yesterday morning, on my YouTube show yesterday morning, asking about ley lines. I can't even remember what the question was that was asked, but it was something about ley lines, did I believe in them, and so on. And all of you out there who are wondering, perhaps have never even heard of ley lines, let me first explain. I don't mean to be think that my knowledge of things is more than anybody else's, but I just want to say, if anybody wants to go out there and check them out, LEY, ley lines, or as the Irish would say, lay as in the LEA, meaning field of or path. All around the world, people have different ideas of what ley lines are, and the Germans, I can't remember now, the Germans think one thing. I know the Irish think that ley lines are fairy paths. I know that the Chinese call them dragon paths or dragon lines. There are lots of different theories about ley lines, and in fact, if you Google ley lines, you will see that people refer to them as those mythical, possibly but not really proved, whatever energy sources or energy lines, a bit like a grid of energy that literally wraps itself around this earth of ours. So as the earth is spinning and going around and around, it is supposedly, many people believe, there is a grid, like a grid of lines and hot spots within those grids, where there are it's so where there are power lines or energy lines with certain hot spots that are particularly powerful. So we're going to talk about those, and we're going to talk a little bit about other things on our planet that might be considered energy fields or energy lines. And what on earth has that got anything to do with Everything Is Attitude? Al.
So, we're going to talk about the broad Earth as a whole, but then we're going to really dig down into energy spots and how you could, maybe your home or a park you love or something like that, that you feel a good energy or not so good energy, and how your attitude can affect
Right.
dealing with those certain spots. But to start, I think this is a topic that's interesting to both of us, Rosemary. I've looked at it for a while. We talked about this really being goes back to ancient times, right? And while you may say there's no proof, we talked earlier about the pyramid system, right? And the pyramid system is really there are pyramids all over the world, not just in Egypt. And if you do some research on that, you could see. And the whole pyramid system was designed around these ley lines, like where to put these pyramids in times where they could not communicate because there was no method of communicating with cultures from around the world. So If you look at things like that and you're objective and open to it, you realize that there is something to it, and we have, as a human species, adhered to these energy fields for a long time, but we have gotten away from it the last, say, 100 years or so. We've really gotten away from it.
Definitely. Well, I think ley lines, or the word ley lines, ley or li meaning a field of lines, or a grid, or something of lines, or a path, as you lay meaning path. If you Google this, you'll read that they were discovered in, I think it was 1921 or something like that, which is almost, not quite, but almost 100 years ago. We're getting up there, you know, got another 2 years to go. But people like myself and people who are sensitive have been aware of energy fields, call them what you like, energy fields, forever. We've been basing our whole lives in ancient times, certainly in the 17, 1800s and before then. People would, if you look at where, especially in England, I can speak to England, particularly myself, but I'm sure that other people around the world can speak to their own countries. The churches, the cathedrals, the towns, the cities, all based on near water, somewhere near water, along water, and along ley lines. And when people in those years ago used to build their spiritual buildings, or buildings that meant a great deal to them, especially all their towns and cities, they would use either, I'll say, dowsers. They use people who could connect with or could find energy lines or energy fields, just like dowsers can find water or silver or gold, even actually in the ground. So people could, in those days, were much more aware of connecting their senses, their sensitivity, even, I'm going to say, even their psychic abilities. They could connect with, and connect with energy that runs along this grid, and it's a magnetic grid. And ley lines are like this magnetic field that surrounds the earth is in the earth and is in the ground. So sort of connecting with them and connecting psychically with energy fields was a huge thing. And, you know, even as recently as, I'm trying to think, about 30 years ago, I met a wonderful, wonderful man, John Michalides, in Greece, in Crete, he was a dowser, and he made his living dowsing. He was also a healer, by the way, but he made his living dowsing. In other words, people would pay him to go and find water, so that the farmers in his town, and everybody knew him all over Crete, people knew this man. And the story of how I found him is an amazing story just in its own self, and he was an amazing, amazing and wonderful man. But he made his living, people all over Crete knew him and knew of him, and would go to him if they needed to plow a field, if they needed to dig a well, if they needed whatever it was. And he was the man who found water. And he used to use his rods to connect with the energy field, to connect with these sources of energy, if you like, these paths of energy that are on this earth. And he was very, very successful at it. But going back to the pyramids, if I may just tell a little story about the pyramids. First of all, I was fascinated. I've been to Egypt, and I've been inside the Great Pyramid at Giza. And I went in there, and it was sort of the most amazing thing, because to go into the pyramids, there are no real steps. You don't just walk in and there's this big expanse of emptiness inside. It's sort of, there are these narrow, I don't know what you could even call them, passageways that go sort of, they go up, but as they're going up, they're going in. And you have to bend double, because you cannot stand up in them. They're sort of, you're crawling along up these little narrow passageways. And as you're going up, you're also going in further and further into the center of the pyramid. And you go so far up, and then you come to a little space, and then you have to step across, and then there's another tunnel that's going up, and you're sort of crawling almost on your hands and knees to get into the into this space, where eventually you come to the place where it was the burial space. The sarcophagus was there, and of course nobody was in the sarcophagus when I went in there. You know, the body had been removed by this time, but it was sort of fascinating to go in there. But this room in the very heart of the very center of the pyramid, the ancients believed, and even today we believe that this space held such energy and such power that was beyond beyond understanding. But this is where they put their whoever it was, the king or whoever it was that the pyramid was built for. And yes, they did all the embalming and so on and so forth, but they firmly believed that this, whatever this energy was that was trapped in this tiny space, actually quite a small space, was for preserving. And it is true, and again, you can look this up, you can go to Google, it's true that if people build a pyramid. Some people have built pyramids in order to go inside to meditate. They've been that big. And other people have built pyramids that are much smaller. But if you use the exact dimensions of the pyramids, and by the way, they're the same dimensions in every country, all throughout the world, they are built the same. Even though, as you said, Al, no communication. We didn't have, you know, there was no way to Google how to build a pyramid.
Exactly.
You know. But there was an experiment done. I can't remember now who by, but this is fascinating to me. There was an experiment done, and that somebody built a pyramid, which was probably, you know, no bigger than I could probably hold it on my lap, right? And they suspended it. And they suspended it, first of all, above a piece of cheese. And they put a piece of cheese on a small platform, and then they suspended the pyramid over it. And I don't know how many weeks or months later, and I mean months or maybe even longer, that piece of cheese was as fresh as it was when they first put it there. They did another experiment with a, I'm surprising you, aren't I, with my knowledge here. But there's another experiment that they did with a razor. And they again suspended the pyramid over this with this blade, the razor blade, I should say, that you know the, you know what I mean, the razor blade, and somebody used it every day to shave. And months and months and months and months later, now you know, I mean, you know, Al, you're a man, you know how razors get, they get blunt, don't they? They,
yeah, sure, no, yeah, sure.
Right, right. The blades get blunt and so on. And they proved by sort of, they'd use it, put it back under the pyramid, and it never got rusty and it never got blunt and it never, and it just stayed as sharp could be. So there's this idea, and of course the Egyptians, they, who knows how they knew it, but they knew it all those years ago, that, you know, that these certain dimensions and this certain, you know, the certain accurate dimensions were somehow held a power or an energy that preserved, and which it has been proved again and again and again that it does do this. And there are people out there who do meditation and so on, and they swear by their homemade pyramids. So, such, you know, so I went into this particular pyramid, but I have to tell you that I won't tell you exactly what happened, but it was a little bit disappointing. Anyway, when I sort of came back out, because you've now got to climb back down and crawl back through these sort of narrow tunnels to get back out again. And we came back out just before I walked out into the sunshine, just inside the entrance to the pyramid. I said to Grey Eagle, you know, well, what was that about then? And he gave me the power sign, you know, the fist, the power sign. people think it's a black power sign, but no, it isn't just theirs, it's for everybody. But he gave me the power sign and he said the word power to me. And I'm thinking, well, okay, then I don't feel any different. Nothing has occurred. But that night, and again, I was in Cairo. That night, I went to bed, I went to sleep. And again, this whole story, I've written it. You know, if you read The Eagle and the Rose, you can read much more about it. And that whole thing was my very first experience of being out of body, fully aware that I was out of body. I was able to look behind my shoulder and I could see my, I know it sounds weird, I know I sound a crazy person, but I could look behind my shoulder and I saw myself, I saw my body curled up in bed, sound asleep. And I stood in this room and I could see the light from the window, I could see the two beds, I was standing between two beds, I could see everything in the room. And I remember my very first thought was, oh, this must be what it's like to be dead. And on from there, lots of other stories about how that power from that, just that small brief amount of time in that pyramid really did impact me. But anyway, we're getting off topic. I thought you'd like that story because it is a great story. And when people talk about the mythical ley lines or the mythical energy field that is around the earth, it might be mythical to some, but it's certainly not mythical to me. I believe it exists, and I've had proof many, many times that it exists. What about you, Al? Do you believe that it exists?
I do. I've watched a lot and read a lot on it. I do believe it exists. If you go certain places, you travel different places, you could you hear people say, oh, I felt great after I left there, or I really want to go back there again. You know, I'm out in Colorado in the mountains, and
wow,
and you know, and we were really drawn to this area because of the energy of the area. Not that the energy where we were was that bad, but coming here, you just felt the difference.
It's a very different type of energy. I know that Phoenix, I mean, I know you're in Colorado, but in Phoenix, which is just your next door neighbor, really, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I mean, there have been supposedly sightings. If you go out into the desert at nighttime, there's been sightings of what some people might consider to be UFOs and so on. And I myself, being out in the desert at night, just on the outskirts of Phoenix, have seen weird lights and weird happenings and so on and so forth. But I think that there are certain pockets of energy or certain spots of energy in every country in the world where if you are a sensitive person, or if you are a natural dowser, or if you're a person who naturally feels or is impacted by energy, you can feel there are certain places, there are certain areas that, you know, you step foot on, you get off a plane, you step foot on in a particular place, and it's like a wow. You know, everybody talks about the energy of Machu Picchu. We talk about the energy, the ancient, I mean, we're talking about the Stonehenge, the stone circles. There are certain spots in Italy that I've been to that it just, you have to hold your breath because it's like all of a sudden something hits you. I was in China for a long time, and I know you have a friend who is a feng shui master.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, feng shui, actually the word means, and I'm not sure which way around it is, but it means air and water, because the Chinese certainly believe, and those, you know, there are these beliefs that the energy of the earth needs an outlet. It needs to have a place to come in. It needs to have a place to flow out. It's much more complicated than that, I know, but I was very, very fortunate one time when I was in Hong Kong to have dinner. I spent several hours with this master. He was a Chinese gentleman, and his father was a feng shui master, his grandfather was a feng shui master, and so on and so forth. So, you know, he grew up with this and he knew exactly what he was doing. And one of the most fascinating things he told me was that it was a very mathematical thing. Well, Al, what did you say to me earlier on when we were talking about this science and math? And
it's, everybody thinks that the science and math is different than from, or, you know, a separate from spirituality and energy, and it's really all the same. I joke, we're all, this is just one big mathematical equation we're living, right?
Yeah, I think, I mean, even if you look at, you know, the physical body, what is it, 90-some% water, our physical bodies?
Yeah.
Whatever that is. So 90%. We're even using math to equate how much fluid is in our bodies. But yeah, you can't separate math and science from, you know, from the spiritual side of things, because I do feel that it is all connected. But
Rosemary, when you do disconnect it, you find through time that science proves it. Like I remember you talking to me about the Russian scientists that, you know, people talk about auras and energy, and, you know, up until
a few years, Semyon and Valentina Kurlian.
Yeah, they actually photographed auras, and here it is.
They actually developed a camera. Can you believe this? This couple, a Russian couple, developed a camera. They were in this little tiny apartment. They didn't have much money. It was Russia in, I can't remember what year it was. I should remember, but anyway. They developed a camera that can actually photograph auras. And now when you, this makes me smile really, because now when you go to all of these psychic fairs and so on, I mean, they have all this stuff out there like it's new and innovative, but it isn't really. But, you know, when they were able to photograph, and what they were doing was, they were, you know, an aura, let's be clear, an aura is simply, the word aura means energy field. And we as human beings, our energy field extends to several feet beyond us. And so when we're when we're able to photograph that energy field, that aura, we call it an aura, but it really is just the ability to photograph the energy field. We can photograph the energy of a leaf, of a plant, any living thing that has an energy field around it. So why would it be so surprising to people? And why would people say that this, you know, ley lines or fairy lines or whatever, dragon, whatever paths, whatever people call them in the different countries and different cultures, why would they say mythical? Because science tells us that everything about us is energy, everything about this earth is energy, everything about this universe is energy. So why would it be so difficult for some people to go that step further and say, but it makes perfect sense to understand that there is this grid, this energy field that is around us, that we, you know, that we refer to as in our culture anyway, we refer to as ley lines. Why is it so mythical? Why is it so hard for people to imagine that? Okay, but now, that was a rhetorical question I gave you there. But, you know, coming back to the idea of us and what we're doing here with this Everything is Attitude, how can we apply this knowledge to our attitude, to our way of life and to how we live? And how can we take advantage of the knowledge that we have? Let me just remind everyone what I said earlier in the, you know, even going back to the early 1900s and way before then, way, way before then. I think we stopped when the Iron Age came, maybe the Mechanical Age came.
Industrial Revolution, yeah.
Yeah, when we had locomotion and we had all this, you know, this, what did you call it again?
The Industrial Revolution.
Industrial Revolution, yeah. Thank you. I think when that happened, people started moving away from the natural order of things, because the idea then of sort of the mechanical stuff and steam and man-made, I mean, I'm sure the wheel was a massive invention. But I think the industrial age, where we sort of all of a sudden we've got locomotives steaming through the ground, and it was way more important to lay down railway lines than ever it was to consider, should we put them here or here? And it was way more important to lay them down wherever, it didn't matter where, as long as the trains could get through. And rather than go around a mountain, they would bl start blasting through the mountains with no regard whatsoever for the natural order of things and for the natural order of this world of ours. And I think probably it was in those days when people started to let go of the idea that we do have, I always like to say, God did not put us on this earth with nothing. We have an ability, we have energy, we have an understanding, but it's been lost with the Industrial Revolution. Then we've had all the computers and
The technology age, yeah, I mean, is even more lost, yeah.
and so people have sort of lost, and very often don't even understand that they have an ability to sense, to feel, to be aware of what's around them, that the earth is trying to tell us something, that if we connect with the earth, we can feel the energy of the earth, and we should know then what to do with where we are, and I think we've lost that. And I think part of this, the world being in such absolute chaos, is that we've lost our way. With the path we were on, which was a spiritual path, not necessarily meaning believing in God, but a spiritual path as in the energy that we have, the energy that the earth has, the way that we would always, years and years ago, all those hundreds of years ago, be able to connect with that energy and to be able to tune into that energy. It's lost. And so consequently, we as human beings, I think we're lost.
Yeah,
So.
I think the concept of, we come from energy, we are energy, we become that energy, or we remain that energy after, that we are we're really part of this whole system where we're interconnected with the earth, we're interconnected with each other, and we're interconnected with that universal force out there. It's almost like you have this, if someone were to say to you, I give you this book and of all the knowledge of the universe, everybody would say, okay, that's great. I have everything I need to know in this book. Yet it is there for people
Knowledge is there, you're right. Knowledge is
if
there.
they just are aware of it, right? And not everything is for our conscious mind to be either handle or know. There are things that we won't know, but for the most part, what is in our the way we are able to connect to the that universal energy, all that knowledge is there. All we have to do is connect to it, and we veered so far off. And it's not something that's this corny, like spiritual thing. Like if it I think people think of it like that, which is why we veered off even more, right? But the reality is, I think people almost overstated or get into it almost too much sometimes. The simplest level is we are energy. The earth has the energy fields. So other people have energy, and that we just connect to that, and that all connects to universal energy. And if
Well,
you look at it simply, right, that makes a big difference.
I think that when people start to talk, oh, spiritual or something, there are people who close off. They just shut off. They don't want to hear it because, oh God, it's her again, or it's him again, or then and people just close off from it. But actually, this is scientifically proved. There is a magnetic field around the earth.
That's mapped out. You could look at the maps of it. Yeah.
Exactly. It is scientifically proved that there are places where there are hot spots, there are hot spots in the universe. I mean, the black hole, we talk about that black hole where we're getting into a whole other thing now, but you know, but there are so many things that go on in our own world on this earth of ours that are, I consider it to be spiritual in a way, because for me, because my spirit connects with that energy. Mm-hmm. So it's not necessarily a belief in God, although I do believe that. It's a belief in my own energy connecting with the energy of this earth and of the universe. And it's solid information that we can use. We know absolutely, sort of coming back to the reason for our show here, we know absolutely that there are certain areas where we can buy a house. People build something, and we know that there, you know, that there is disruptive energy in a way that the ancients would never build across a ley line, because you are disrupting or disturbing the energy of the earth, the natural energy of the earth. Nobody cares. Just, there's a piece of land, let's bung up a house here, let's put a village there. Hey, why don't we build a city here? Nobody's looking at the energy and the energy field around it. I had years ago, I've only just remembered this, I forgot this when we were talking earlier, but years ago, I had an architect who came to see me on a fairly regular basis. Once he discovered my ability, and it's a weird ability, I don't know, but I was able to not only see, he wasn't not just an architect for houses, he was an architect for sort of these huge properties, golf courses and different things and so on, and you know, he was sort of built huge complexes, and I would be able to say to him, okay, there's a hill over there and a valley here and so on, and I would describe the area, and then I would say, you can't build there because, and then I would give him a reason why. But I was connecting in with the energy of the place. And he sometimes, because it was important for the owners of this place to build there, he would ignore me, or he would just think, oh, well, you know, the owners want it there, so let's do it. And you could guarantee there was always a problem. And he'd come back to me and he'd say, I know you told me not to do it, but we did it, and this happened. Major disruption, major issues. What can I do to rectify that? Where can I put this? And I've worked with maps with people. People have given me maps of certain areas, and you can pinpoint, and you know about using the pendulum, right, Al? I mean, we use the pendulum. I teach my students. It's one of the basic things I like to teach them, because the pendulum is an extension of our energy connecting in with the energy that is around us. And it's a fascinating, fascinating subject. Back to, what can we do to improve our attitude, to help our attitude, especially those of us, and I'm sure there are so many people out there listening who will relate to this. I bought a house, I had nothing but trouble, or we had nothing but illness, or it was a really awful time, you know, whatever. And some people might even say, and there were lots of hauntings there and so on and so forth. How can we use this knowledge of energy and energy grids, energy fields, ley lines, call it what you will, how can we use that to help us in our quest for a great attitude?
I think, you know, if we're talking like we always do as a recipe, both inform yourself about those energy fields and do the research, but also have an awareness. If you don't have an awareness, we said before, you know, bring your kids with you.
You said that earlier on. Your kids will tell you.
Your kids will tell you, because they don't have all this stuff blocking, but even if you don't want to tap into the energy, do your research on the house. Like, who was in the house before? You mentioned, was there an illness? Did the people get divorced? You know, was there a fire? Like, all these different things that you could actually just research on whatever location either you're currently in, or you're looking from the community to the general geographic area to just specifically that house in particular, do your research and get informed and be aware of what's that the energy fields do affect things, right?
Yeah, I think to make sure that you do not only you do not discard information. For instance, you might hear of a house where three people have owned it and three people have gotten divorced. You know, three couples have owned it before you, three couples got divorced. Don't discard that information. It doesn't mean that if you buy it, you're going to get divorced, but pay attention because maybe there's something about the house or where it's built or even the builders. It could have an effect because everything is energy and everything absorbs energy. Buildings absorb energy. And so, you know, don't just discard information. I mean, pay attention to it. You might find that a house is going really cheap. You know, you think, oh, well, you know, that's a good deal. Pay attention. Why? Pay attention when you go into a building, whether it's a workspace, whether it's a house you're going to buy, whether it's a school that your children are going to go into. I mean, pay attention. So always be aware of that, you know, that voice, that feeling, that sense. And if you sort of, as you go into places and you sort of get tuned in. So I'm part of the recipe is make sure that you are tuned in and you're paying attention to your feelings and you're paying attention to your senses and your sensitivity. Don't just go in there and look around and say, oh, this is great, or the floors are dirty, or this and that. It's not about what the building looks like. It's about what it feels like.
And Rosemary, it's almost like if we're using a house as an example and you're looking at different places to live, or you're looking at an apartment, when you go into a place like that, like you said, don't start looking like, does it have a big bedroom? Just stop for a moment and just your first initial gut feeling, what is it? Before you start looking at the bells and whistles. So really get down to, like you said, paying attention, but look at that first feeling. You see it sometimes. We've all looked at houses. You walk into a certain house and it's like, wow, this feels amazing. And then you walk into another house and it just feels awful right away. So people know it, but then it gets really foggy once you start saying, oh, they have a fireplace or they have a pool.
This house is $5,000 less than that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and it does, you're right. It starts to get foggy because we're not used to paying attention.
Right.
So the recipe, I think, is about paying attention. You know, that's sort of make sure that you are tuned in. So, you know, the tuning in, the being sensitive, being aware, listening, feeling, you know, throw all those senses and sensitivities into your bowl and mix them all together. You know, get this recipe going, because this is and here is a part of the problem, because you might, especially if you're buying a house, for instance, you might go into a place, it's the price you can afford. It's got four bedrooms and you've only ever had three before, or it's got a swimming pool, or it's got this and this. And there's such a temptation to take the bargain. And everybody's wanting to take the bargain, or everybody's wanting to have a bargain. And the temptation is to just go for it, you know, absolutely, because it's the bargain. But if your gut or if your inner self is saying there's something not quite right with this, or it doesn't feel quite right, forget the bargain and pay attention to your feelings and your senses and your sensitivity. It might just be that there is a negative energy in the place, or there has been a negative energy in the place, and you can easily do something about that. You can get a priest, or you can get feng shui, master,
a cleansing, energy cleansing, right?
Yeah, you can get, you know, Native American to come in, or you don't even have to be Native American. You get somebody in who knows how to use sage. to cleanse and to clean and to give a clean sweep. Or you can go to somebody like me and you can say, what do you think to this house, or what does it feel like to you? If you're doubting your own self, if you feel that you're not quite sensitive enough, or you can't trust your senses or your sensitivity because you just want the bargain, get somebody else involved who can, you know, who can help you to you know, understand what there is here. Get somebody who is in tune. If you can't get in tune yourself, get somebody else in the mix to say to them, you know, what do you think? And as you said earlier, Al, the best, you know, take your dog or take your pet. Exactly. Yeah. Your dog will know straight away.
Yeah, exactly.
or take your kids. And it's the same with, you know, going to a park or a play area. When my grandson he's started, I don't know what it's called, kindergarten. Anyway, six, whatever it is, he's six. And he went to this school, and Samantha was thrilled to bits because it was just around the corner, which meant that she could get up 5 minutes before they were due to go to school, whip something on really fast, you know, not quite, but you know what I'm saying. It was so convenient. It was so easy. It was just around the corner. And it was a beautiful school, and it was brand new. And he was doing really well there. He was settled there. But then he got into a program. I think they have it in America. It's called the Gifted and Talented program. And he was offered a place at a gifted and talented school. And Samantha was saying to me, the school is not as nice. It's old. It's, you know, it's a bit run down. It's this and this. And so comparing buildings, it was, you know, the one he was in, and he was settled in this new one, and would he be okay? And we went back and forth with it. And so in the end, I took my way of looking, which I know most people can't do, but my way of looking was I didn't have to go to the building. And of course, I also asked Grey Eagle because I cheat. So, what should we do about this? But we were interested in the first of all, the energy of the building, because that's important. Because if the energy is good, then the ability for teachers to teach well and the students to be happy is going to be, you know, much more so than it would if the building had negative energy. And so we looked at that. And we looked at the teachers, and he eventually moved there. And it means my daughter has to travel 45 minutes on a train every morning, but he loves his school and he's doing so well there. So it all worked out. But it was a question. My point is, don't just take something because somebody says it's good to you and, oh, okay, then. Pay attention to the fact that everything is energy. We are all energy. Every one of us has an energy field that surrounds us. There are people who can see auras, and those people who can see auras, you know, that's okay for them. I remember a story about there was a church, and there was an old lady who used to always sit on the front pew of this church. And they had a new minister come in, and everybody was raving about the new minister. And this old lady, she would just go to the service, and then she never really talked to anybody afterwards. She'd sort of come in, she'd sit down, she'd go through the service, and then she'd leave, and then she'd do the same thing week after week. That was her life. And everybody was raving about this new minister until he ran off with all the funds from the church. And so they had a big church meeting because everybody wanted to know what we do about this and so on. And this old lady went to the church meeting, and she was extremely puzzled that everybody should be surprised. And she said, but didn't you, you know, you, but you, you know, you could, couldn't, did, could, didn't you see his energy was dark? And without even knowing it, she could see auras, or she could see the energy field, and it never occurred to her that other people couldn't. So, you know, one way or another, pay attention to the energy, pay attention to the energy field that is around you, and put all of that into the mix in your recipe when you're either going to a new school, even to a hospital, or, you know, a clinic or a party or whatever it is you're doing and wherever it is you are. if you pay attention to your senses, to your sensitivity, and to your feelings, that, you know, and take that attitude of, wait a minute, I have this incredible, you know, it's almost like an antenna that we have. I have this incredible antenna
that can tune into that universal.
Why don't I start using it?
Yeah.
And, you know, and if you take that attitude of, hold on a minute, I'm not useless, I'm not helpless, I do have this ability to help myself, I do have this ability to know things. And in relationships and meeting people, use the antenna.
Yeah, I was going to say, it applies to anything, right?
Everything. I mean, don't just...
Doctors you choose, everything, right?
It's... Unfortunately, in our materialistic age, we tend to look at the package, don't we? We tend to only see the pretty ribbons and the bows and the pretty paper. We tend to sort of be blinded by what something looks like as opposed to what something feels like.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, the message that we're trying to get over here is we do have our tools in our toolbox. We do have this incredible energy field, not just around us, but within us. But we also have the earth that is telling us something. If only we can, you know, take a moment to breathe and to tap into it, we can feel, we can learn, we can use our senses and our sensitivities to, you know, to guide us through our life. And the arrogance of the human being can be astounding to me, and I'm using that term for me as well as everybody else. The arrogance that, you know, that the ancients, oh well, that was then, you know, we now have all this technology, you know, we're in this industrial age, we have the machines, we have the trains, we have all of this, you know, we don't need to go back, we don't need to think about how did the ancient Egyptians build the pyramids. Oh, wait a minute, without all of the machinery, by the way, that we have today. You know, there are so many wonders of the world. I can't remember what country it's in now, but sort of high up, miles and miles up above the, you know, but there's this massive waterfall, and at the top sits this enormous, enormous stone. And people are puzzling still today, how did it get up there? Because it doesn't belong there, but how did it get up there? Mm. And there is a theory that the ancients, again, used music and used the energy of music to lift the boulder. You know, it's a sort of kinetic energy.
Yeah.
And there are people who say, but it doesn't exist. And I can tell you, yes, it does exist.
Rosemary, if you look at even, you know, here in America, if you're in America, you know, we came to America from Europe and dismissed what the Native Americans knew, their knowledge as primitive and archaic. We swing back around now, we realize they're thousands and thousands of years ahead of what we know today, or the kind of this funnel of, you know, we really have taken all of this wonderful knowledge and thrown it away or forgotten about it in really a short amount of time.
In a very short amount of time. But if you look at, you know, the ancients, the grandfathers, every culture in the world, every single culture in the world has, if you go back far enough, has this amazing understanding of, you know, energy fields, senses, sensitivity. They have this knowledge that there's way more to the earth than we could ever imagine. I mean, they created things. Look at the obelisks that they have in Egypt. We go back right back to Egypt. Not only do they have the pyramids, and they have obelisks all over the world. An obelisk is this like long, tall sort of, it just really looks like a big stone, but it's several feet, you know, some of them are several feet high. They stand in the middle of somewhere. How did it get there? How did they get there? And, you know,
what was their purpose, right?
What was their purpose? You know, why did people? And there's some, especially in Egypt, there's talk of, you know, well, they took them up the river, or they brought them up the river, and so on. Yeah, but okay, Yes, we can understand that, but how do they get to stand right up there all by themselves? It's like, you know. So, yes, you're talking about the Native Americans, and I look at the, you know, the old Chinese traditions, the Japanese traditions, the Far East and the Middle East, and people who were called magis, people who were, you know, we go back to sort of Merlin and all of the magical stuff that happened and so on. And we look at, I know that Merlin's a mythical figure, but we sort of, you know, we look at these people who were in their day seers, sages, people who knew and had knowledge. And today, in our society today, we don't have those people anymore. There's
No.
nobody there. If we want to know something, oh, wait a minute, let's Google it then.
Exactly.
You
We have
know.
a number of comments, Rosemary, if you want
Oh,
to go.
great. Yes,
So we
absolutely.
have a number of people saying hello.
Hello.
Maggie asked about purchasing a house, what's the best ley line position. I think it probably is circumstantial, right?
I'm
Where
sorry, what house?
she said when buying a house, what is the best in ley line position?
Houses should lay along a ley line, not it's where it's and unfortunately, it's probably hard to find somewhere that doesn't somehow cross or disturb the energy field. But the only way you'll know it now is to go in, or you can do it. Actually, there are a few ways to do it when I think about it. You can go in there and you can get a feel and a sense. And if it feels right and it feels good and if it feels comfortable and the energy feels right to you, then it probably is. So that's one way, but you have to tune into your own energy to understand that. You can get a dowser in. You can get somebody like myself who can sort of map it out for you. You can get a dowser. You can, you know, use a pendulum. You can get a seer or a sage or some wise person to come and check it out for you. Be careful though, because there are a lot of people out there who say they can do it, and we all know that, you know,
It could steer you the wrong way
they
completely.
could, really could. And there are people who are they're out there just to make money, and they really don't know quite what they're doing. So be cautious and be careful. But I would say if you don't have anyone around you who you can trust, trust yourself, trust your own feelings, your own sense, your own sensitivity. Wouldn't you say that, Al?
Yes, exactly. We have Colagero, says, "Good evening, Rosemary.
Good evening.
Pleasure to see you live. Your person gives me peace and truth. This is beautiful. Thank you."
Oh, well, he can see us live every Friday here. He
At
can see us
first,
live
you are.
every Thursday on YouTube at 11 a.m. Standard Eastern Time, and lots of other places, I think, as well. But thank you.
Mary says, "Hi, lovely Rosemary and Al." She's happy that your dog, doggy, is okay, she says.
Thank you. Good energy, good healing energy.
Nettie's on. She says, "Fascinating." Annalisa, "Hi, Rosemary." Mary,
Hi,
"So interesting." Jeff is on. "Hi, Rosemary and Al."
hi. Well, Jeff is very involved with a particular Native American tribe, and he knows all about energy. He does sweats. He goes into the sweat lodge, and it's all about energy and so on. So he's probably fascinated.
Yes, he has a number of comments that people could read some of them afterwards. He says, "I believe that understanding the energy of nature, including our own humanity, has been lost because of the physical comforts afforded us by
Right,
the material
because
world."
which is what we just were talking about. Yeah,
Exactly.
yeah, yeah.
Mary says, "When I go to my hometown in London, I find an amazing energy there too, sometimes even more so."
Good.
So probably because I am born and bred Londoner, but maybe not, right? Maybe it's just good energy there too.
Maybe just good energy. Yeah, there are certain parts of, well, every city in the world that just really special. I remember there was a place in Hong Kong. I was, you know, when I was in Hong Kong. It's a very hustle and bustle city, and I can remember being with my friend Kay, who I stayed with when I was over there, And we were rushing, we were shopping actually, we were rushing from this place to this place, and we're in a part of Hong Kong where it was just the Chinese culture, the Chinese community. And we went there fairly often, but there was always this one spot that I couldn't wait to get past. And it was just like an alleyway, really. It was not even dark. I wasn't worried about thieves and vagabonds, but it was just this one spot that I forced myself to run through. I couldn't go around it because of the situation of the roads and so on, but I had to run through it because it just was such negative energy. And so I would hold my breath and just run through it and just keep positive. So there are spots, good spots and bad spots all over the world.
Jeff just said Andrea is here too.
Oh, hi, darling.
We have Emma, really a good question here, comment. She says, what if you are in a street that was a war zone like 50 or 70 years ago? There is definitely something spirit-like here, she said.
Yeah, and you can feel.
Scotland, UK.
Sorry?
She says in Scotland, UK, that's where she is.
My grandmother was from Stirling. She'll know what that means. Well, I think again, where there has been tragedy, where there has been trauma, where there has been happiness, it's all energy, and our earth, our buildings absorb the energy, which is why very often I can go into a building and feel and absolutely know just by the feel of the building that something awful happened there. So this is what she's saying. In a war-torn area, people can obviously feel that, the tragedy or the pain. You tune in or you tap into whatever there was going on there. I can remember being asked to go. There's a story in my book, A Matter of Life and Death, and it's a great book, by the way. But there's a story in there. Do not read this story if you're faint of heart, because some people get upset about it, because we do talk about evil, because evil does exist. And I was asked to go into this particular house to check something out, and I can remember walking into this apartment that was next to the house, attached to the house. I remember walking in there, and remember that I'm an extremely sensitive and tuned in person. But I can remember the moment I walked in, and I was fine until I went to walk behind the sofa. And what it was there in that particular spot was, it was as if a big muscly football, imagine this, you've got this big muscly guy throwing a football right into your midsection, right into your solar plexus. And it was like this powerful foof like this. And I literally doubled over with the energy and the force of the energy, which actually was really quite pure evil. Please don't think that that's going to happen to all of you. I don't want people to get worried about it. This is just me doing my job. Sometimes we come across these things, and because I am so sensitive, I'm so aware of that stuff. And it was my job to get rid of it, which actually I did. Again, the story is in A Matter of Life and Death, if anybody wants to go in, but don't read it if you're faint of heart, because it is a true story, and you can see it. You can check it out on wherever people check. Go to the FBI files, that sort of thing. Anyway, but the point is that in that place, in that particular spot, there was an energy which was so awful and horrible that it was just hard to deal with. Even for me, it was hard to deal with. And I've come across negative energy on a number of occasions through my life. Let's have some more comments, Al.
Those were the rest of the comments. Jess says thank you for the native acknowledgement of native wisdom.
You're welcome.
Mary says, I had problems, Rosemary, when I came to rent a flat in Italy. I felt terrible. I remember with your help and Grey Eagle, I do feel better where she is now.
Brilliant.
I never knew really why, but I have nearly 3 years now, and it's a bit better.
Good.
And
Brilliant.
that's the thing. Sometimes you don't know, right? The why of things. I
Well,
remember.
it's actually, you know, if you start, I think if you start to get into the why of a thing, you start to move away from the feel of the thing.
Right, that's true. Yeah, very, very true.
It only matters that if it feels wrong. And sometimes you're in a place before you realize that it's not a good place or the energy is negative and so on. But there are then things that you can do. People do contact me, and I like to think, you know, I send out the big guns. I send Grey Eagle out there. Well, I don't really send him. He goes, you know, is it because I don't tell him what to do?
And you could do things like, I know I've experienced things going to a museum or an exhibit, and you're feeling good walking through the place, and then you go to another area and you just feel awful, and you don't know why. So there are places that you can go, and a museum is one of. I remember I went to a Titanic exhibit, and you know, I was enjoying, because I'm a history buff. I started as a history teacher, and I was enjoying the
I
whole
did
thing.
that. I didn't know that.
But then I walked into this one section where it was just overwhelmingly negative, and it turned out it was all the artifacts from the ship that they had put in this one small area.
How interesting.
So I, of course, wanted to run out of there. But those kind of things, you realize, especially when you're not paying attention and you just feel something, and you. But a museum is a great place to try and figure out, what am I feeling? Why am I feeling it? Because you're exposed to so many different energies, from, you know, ancient things, some more recent things. So it's a neat way to just kind of test out that basic instinct or basic gut feeling of energy, right?
I think what we're actually saying is that, and I'm going to say it again, I do not believe that we were thrown onto this earth without tools. We have tools, we have knowledge, we have capabilities. I do not think that God or that God force or whatever it is threw us out here to say, get on with it. I think we were put here with certain tools that we can use. And one of those tools, and probably the most important, is our sixth sense. Which is, you know, our five senses combined to create this incredible sixth sense that, you know, some of us have it naturally, and well, we all of us have it naturally, but some of us tune into it naturally, and some of us have more of a struggle to tune into it. But I think that if we became, and this is my recipe for life, ever, forever, for everybody, my recipe for life is, and of course I do it every day, tune in, even if you don't feel that you've got any particular capabilities, you do have energy. You are an energy field within your own self. You are your energy field extends several feet beyond you. It can, as we said, it can be photographed now, thanks to Semyon and Valentina Kirlian, and it can be photographed. So sort of it's almost like when you're going into a new place or when you are sort of you know, wanting to check something out, it's almost like putting out your tentacles, putting out your feelers, and put out those feelers and use your energy. Even if you don't feel it or you don't know it or you don't understand that you've got it, once you start to use it and once you start to try to use it and start to try to tap into it, you can literally put out those feelers and you become much more aware. All of a sudden, you're much more aware, you're much more in tune. And that way, you are liable to make less mistakes with the people that you come into contact with. You're likely to make less mistakes in buying a house. You're likely to make less mistakes in social environments. And in every way, you're much more likely to make less mistakes as you tread upon this earth, as you tread your path and you go on this journey that we're all on. You're likely to make much less mistakes in living your life, and you're likely to have a much more positive attitude. And
And Rosemary, and these are things that people could practice, right? Sit down next to on a busy street, and as people go by, just get a feel for them, and don't put too much into it. Just what you feel, what you feel. Or like I said, go to a museum, or just in general, really be basic, basic, basic. Get down to the basic. We're doing that class where we're teaching students, where you're teaching students how to really get down to the basic with the discipline piece, and that's really all it's about. Like accepting that we are energy. We're part of this energy. Being aware of that energy, but also and being open to it too, right? And then just practice without any preconceived notions,
any expectations.
Exactly. Well,
I will tell a quick story and then we're going to finish this because it's fascinating. This is a really fascinating topic for me. But I remember being in Hong Kong and in a part of Hong Kong that was, I won't say it was unsavory, but it was sort of, you know, probably an area that if you're a Westerner, you wouldn't go into it necessarily. And I had a patient of mine and we'd just been to see a fantastic old man who was an herbalist. He was one of the most fascinating people I've ever met in my life, but that's a whole other story. And so this patient of mine, Chris, he wanted some healing. He was sick, and so we were coming from the herbalist and we were looking for a place to, and he thought healing, quiet place, you know, got to find somewhere quiet, maybe a park, maybe somewhere where we can sit where there's no hustle and bustle. And we were right in the heart of this. This street was so busy, traffic, trucks, you name it, you know, and it was fairly narrow street, but it was, I mean, the noise. And if anybody's ever been to Hong Kong, you know that there's a lot of noise in Hong Kong, traffic and all the rest of it. And so I sat down, looked out, there's a little cafe there. Well, it was like a little hole in the wall cafe. So, and he looked at me and he said, well, how are you going to give me healing there? And I said, easily. And we crossed and we went into this little cafe and we sat at this tiny little formica type table, and the place was fairly full of regulars, all Chinese, of course. And then there were two Westerners walking in as we sat onto one side. And as so we're talking, we ordered something, we ordered a drink or something. And then I came behind him and I put my hands on him and I said, I just want you to just close your eyes and go with it and trust me. He said, I don't know how I'm going to get rid of all that noise, that sound. And I said, absorb my energy and you will. And we spent 10 or 15 minutes doing this. And then at some point I looked up and there were all these Chinese people sort of, I don't know where they'd come from. They'd come from the street. They'd come from inside the little, this little cafe. And we were surrounded and they hadn't said a single word. Not one of them had said a single word. But they all were staring and also participating in their way because they understood without words. I don't speak Chinese. My daughter speaks Cantonese, but that's beside the point. I certainly don't. But they knew exactly what I was doing because they knew to tune into that energy. And they were just all sort of like, wow, you know, and wanted to be a part of that experience. So anywhere in the world and in any crowded city or in a quiet place or whatever it is, use that energy, tune in and use it as tentacles, spread those tentacles out. And that's our recipe for tonight. We have run over time. I know we've way gone past time, Al, but it's just been a fascinating conversation as far as I'm concerned. If you want to know more about everything his attitude, please, Al will put up the email info@everythingisattitude.com. If you have a subject you'd like us to talk about, if you want to come on our show, you don't even have to be on camera if you don't want to. Any way you want to come on, we'd love to have you as a guest, or we'd like to hear whatever you'd like. You can email Al@alpisano, alpisano.com. You can email me rosemary@rosemaryaltair.com if you have a subject you'd love for us to discuss or you'd like our opinion on or whatever. We love, love, love having you. We thank you all for giving us your time. Oh, wait, and your energy. And Al, thank you so much for being here, my darling co-host. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you, Jeff and Andrew, for tuning in, and all the rest of you, of course. Just happens that Jeff and Andrea are my special friends and I love them to pieces. And so you can see us on YouTube, 11 a.m. Standard Eastern Time on every Thursday morning. You can see us on this show, 6 o'clock Standard Eastern Time. Of course, for all of our students out there on our online course, I'm having so much fun with those students. Are you having fun with our online students?
We are. And we're going to do a Saturday workshop that people could do too, right, Rosemary?
I forgot all about that. Yes, yeah, so it's sort of, is it a workshop or what is it? It's like a, we're going to do a Saturday morning. If you are interested, we will be charging a fee for this. It'll be just, it's like a ticketed event. Sometime we wanted to do it in April, but April is upon us. So within the next, let's say, within the next 4 to 6 weeks, we're going to have a probably a Saturday morning. You know, 3 hours or
Live
4 hours.
event online, right?
A live event. We should be fielding questions. You don't, you know, you don't have to be a student. It's just for everybody out there. It's a live event, and you never know, I might be giving messages as well. Oh, messages from the spirit world. Yay! Wouldn't that be fun? So yes, if you'd like to know more about that again, email Al at alpisano.com or myself, Rosemary at rosemaryaltea.com, and we'll give you any information as and when it comes. If you'd also like to be on our mailing list, Rosemary at rosemaryaltea.com, just tell us, email me, tell me you want to be on the mailing list so you'll get all of that information as and when it comes in. In the meantime, until we see you again, I think I've covered everything, right, Al?
I think
Moving
so, yeah.
on, yeah. In the meantime, until we see you again, please, you all know what I'm going to say. Please, please, please have a very, very, very blessed.